Hey, what's up everybody? Welcome to another Touchdesigner tutorial. Uncharacteristically with this one, we're going to go from scratch. So we're going to be working on that, the line formation or the grid formation made out of particles that you were seeing in the first few seconds of this. So anyway, should be a pretty quick one. It's a fairly simple network. So we're going to start from scratch. We're going to grab a grid SOP. We're going to change this to 500 rows by 50 columns, and then we're going to change the size of this. I kind of like it to fit the Instagram reels, 1920 or 1080 by 1920 vertical format. That's just what I make my things as. So rather than actually make it that large, what I'm going to do is just essentially move the decimal place over a few spots. So I'm going to have 1.080 1080 for my width, and then 1.920 1920 for my height. There we go. You can see it over here. Got it. Good. Great. Wonderful. Okay, so from here we're gonna need is that a transform? I don't think we actually need it, but it's so frequently used in these SOP chains that I'm gonna put it there anyway. Alright, we need this is what's gonna drive everything. We need a particle SOP. So there's our particle SOP engine. Let's make this a little bigger. There we go. I just like to do that. It gives priority. Let's put these up. Alright, cool. So I'm also going to throw in a sort SOP. And then I am going to change the orientation of this. Well, actually, let's see. It looks like it is oriented the way I want. I want it on the XY plane. Oh, I think I see what's happening. It looks like this. My viewer has automatically reoriented itself. So, where the hell is my XY plane? Okay, there we go. I think it was just a combination of not enough particles and the sort method that was being used that was making it look like it was laid out flat along the z-axis rather than being up like that. If I change my sort to random, you can see you'll see the whole grid form. Yeah, there we go. So you can at least see the shape, and then the way the particles are moving are determined by the behavior. Over here. So let's add. We're gonna need not a ton, but more than the default. So I'm gonna set my pixel value to 3500. And then I'm gonna leave everything else exactly as it is. So there we go. There's our particle system. So that's kind of the engine that drives this whole thing. The other thing we're gonna need. We're gonna need a meta ball. We're actually gonna need two meta balls. But let's get this one set up first. So all right. So meta ball, a merge SOP, and then we also need a force. Drag that into the third input on our particle system. Okay. Alright, so I'm going to copy this, paste this. And then actually, before I do that, wait. Sorry, just kidding. So let's attach these. And then, alright, so right now what you see is we have these two meta balls in the same place, which we don't want. So what we're going to do is we're going to offset two of them. One up about, let's say, 0.3 along the y-axis, and then we're going to do exactly the opposite of the second one. We're going to move it down 0.3. Oops, not my radius. Alright, and then let's decrease the radius. So what we want are these, the two meta balls causing forces to act on this particle system, spaced apart. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw a transform SOP in here, and then we're going to animate it so they spin around each other in a circle. I'm going to create some pretty interesting interference patterns in this. So let me actually go ahead and set up the render network so we can watch this in the background, because this is kind of where it starts to get cool. Okay, so I don't think we're going to need anything else, but I'm going to add a null there just in case we need to add something in the chain. Then I'm going to set up my render network. So we're gonna show the particles with instancing, and we're going to use a rectangle as our instanced geometry, so we connect that to geo. Let's add camera to light. Let's add render top. And connect that to an RGB key, so we have a black background. And put a null at the end, and then turn the background. Alright, cool. So we have a white rectangle. Very exciting. Let's make it very small. No, not negative one. Let's make it like 0.3. So there it is. Very, very small. Alright, so let's go into our geo and turn on instancing. And then we'll drag our SOP into the default instance op spot, and then let's set our translate values based on our drop down here. We just want, actually for now, let's just keep it at P1 and P2. Adding this in, you start to get the particles moving in the Z direction as well, and I kind of liked the way that it looked when it was just acting as a 2D grid. So, I'm not exactly sure how to describe it, but it's kind of a cool look. So, alright, so anyway, this is what we're starting with. If we add in some animation, let's do our the usual, the polyhop timeline method. Bear with me, I do this so many times, I'm just slogging through it. If you know this one, great. If I guess I'll just talk through it. If you know it, sorry, just bear with me. Alright, so what we're doing is we're adding in a timeline chop. We're going to turn on the range end button, which is going to give us both the full length of our timeline down here and what frame it's on. If we move that into a math chop and then combine the channels by dividing, we get a normalized ratio of where we're at by frame in the timeline. Then we put that into a lookup chop, then in the second input of the lookup, we create this sine cosine merged pattern, which results in circular motion. So anyway, we need a sine pattern. We need a, I'm just gonna paste that, and then we change this to cosine. We need to merge these. Grab a merge. Go. And we'll drag that into the second input, and there we go. We have our nice looping motion. Okay, so I'm gonna grab this channel, and I am going to, or rather, I'm gonna make the viewer active, and I'm gonna go to my transform SOP here. So let's see if I can remember exactly what we want to do. I think. So it's not X, is it Y? It's Y either. So maybe it's Z. Okay, so what we're going to do is, yeah, you can see it in the transform SOP viewer over there. What we're going to do is we're going to spin these in the Z direction, and they're going to move in a circle through our grid and cause interference with the particles. So, so let's actually, we need to make some range adjustments on this. So we want, I think we want it to go, let's just try a full circle. I think when I was actually working with this, I wound up making it a movement of like 45 degrees or something, but what the hell, we'll see. So we need to change it from a range of -1 to 1 to a range of 0 to 360, and we may come back and change that. So let's just grab channel 1's fine, and then we'll go to our transform here, and we'll drop it into the Z value. Okay, and nothing's changing, so it's just because we have no forces acting on it. But if you look in our window here, you can see that the movement's happening. I'm going to make the timeline a little bit longer, actually twice as long really, just so our movement's not quite as hectic there. All right, so let's turn on some directional force and see what happens here. So we have things moving in the Z direction. So if I turn on my vortex force, there you go, you can see the meta ball's moving in a circle, and actually move these up to like 0.5 and negative 0.5. So we can, this, if it's not the best looking thing, it at least pretty clearly demonstrates what's happening. So so there we go. So we have our meta balls spinning in a circle around each other. We have vortex force applied. And so as we're moving through this particle grid here, we see that. Now where this gets kind of interesting is when you change the sort method to, let's say you wanted lines moving up. If you get it by Y, then you start to see stuff like this happen. And if we pull the level of our force down a good bit, then you know we get some really pretty nice and subtle motion. Let me up my res on this a little bit. Actually, let me just go ahead and change this to and then let me move the camera in a that's cool. All right, so that's basically it. What you can do with this, things to play with to get different looks. You can mess with your sort value. If you change it to by X, it goes like this. You can mess with the number of particles, depending on what your CPU, GPU can handle. I have all my viewers on right now, which is probably eating some frame rate. Let me fix that real quick. Yeah, there we go, back up to 60. Okay, so yeah, but I mean, you can mess with the number of particles. This starts to look real different if you have 10 times the number of particles, for instance. Pretty cool. Ooh, I might have to make something out of this. Yeah. So, you can, similarly, fewer particles can be kind of interesting as well. Reset that. Get a much more sparse animation, which, depending on what you're doing, might be the effect you want. Similarly, you can mess with the size of your rectangle that's being instanced. If you want to make it look more like line art, you can up it a bit so you don't see them as particles. What else? Playing with the different directional forces is also going to yield a lot of different results. Right now, you can see axial force isn't doing anything, and I think that's because it's we have the direction set to 1 in the Z direction, but nothing happening on our X and Y planes. And since we're just using X and Y values in our instancing network, we really just have a 2D grid being generated here. So, if I change the direction to Y and then increase axial force, we can start to see some things happen. I guess another thing you could play around with while we're at it is you could make this a 3D instancing network. And of course, once you have 3D, then you start playing around with camera movement and all kinds of stuff. So there's there's a lot of different ways to explore what on its face is a pretty simple technique. What else could we do? Just see what closest neighbor looks like. It's kind of nice. See what that looks like. Okay, cool. And then just to tie this back to the post I made with this system a while ago, let me show you what I did just to sort of polish up the look. So I added a simple feedback from the image filters. You can do the same thing with a feedback loop and an overtop or a composite set to add or over. But whatever, this is already there. So this just gives us some trails on our particle movement. And if we go into the feedback menu here, we can adjust the opacity on that and get more or less intense trails depending on what we're wanting. So that's pretty cool looking. Alright, so we have some feedback, and then the other thing is pretty much as always some RGBA delay and some bloom. I think in this case the bloom was first. Let's fix that. Let's put a the way down. There we go. Okay, so now you're kind of seeing what it looked like in those pieces. If we bump our glow level a bit with a red glow, it doesn't really look red so much as it starts to look kind of, I don't know, like glowing copper almost. And then if we add RGBA delay, then we get some additional color tones in there that are cool. Oh, I forgot to do this before, but see these little extra points that get added here? Let me get rid of those. If in state we add remove unused points, it should get rid of them. I always forget to do that. Okay, yeah, I'm not seeing them anymore. If one does appear, then I guess I'm a liar, but so far so good. Okay, so anyway, back to this with this one. I'm using the same settings on this that I usually do nowadays, which is -1 on blue, -2 on green, -3 on red. And then last thing I did was throw an additional bloom in after the RGBA delay. And I think I attached, I attached that. So, okay, so let's, so we're almost there. Glow color is going to be white. Throw intensive. Threshold's going to be 0, intensity is going to be to taste. I think the opacity on our feedback is starting to get a little washed out, so we'll pull that back. Alright, and then so those additional artifacts we're getting, these kind of circular things, that's from this having whatever precedes it in the chain, set up the bloom ramp colors. It results in that this kind of tie-dye looking thing. So depending on how much of that we want, if we have what's happening here where both of these are plugged into both inputs, or this is plugged into both inputs, we can just adjust the ramp glow level to get more or less of that effect. So if we just want like a little tiny bit of that to show up when it really gets bright, kind of like this, then that's what we do. And then you can play around with this. I think, yeah, a little more intense was sort of what I went with. So there you go. That's it. I'll see you all at the next one.